leather-bound books.
So I got that going, which is nice.
Now,
here's Tom.
Saturday morning, welcome to the Saturday Sports Page. I'm Tom Schmitz, along with Ryan Goldberg. No Austin Tappman today. We're going with Goldberg. Austin's done. We're tired of the losers. He's out of here.
You gonna call him a loser?
Who cares? He's no longer here. I'm not studying him. He left to go teach golf. I played golf with him.
I've played golf with him, too. He's better than me, so I can't
compare. Yeah. Somebody needs to teach him how to play golf. Just saying. Tried to get in touch with J.J. LaSalva this morning so we could get some World Cup talk in because J.J. is an expert on soccer. Somebody's at his brother Josh's graduation because that's important. World Cup, the most popular sporting event in the world. The World Cup starts in a week, less than a week. And people are worried about high school graduations instead.
You could have them on Wednesday. That's the day before.
Friendly today. The United States in Jacksonville today, playing in a friendly at Everbank Stadium.
How exciting is that? How local is that? It's crazy.
Yeah, you could go today, spend $40, and see the U.S. national team play Nigeria in the last game before the World Cup starts for them.
It was Brazil and Portugal. I was also playing in New England at Foxborough, where the Patriots play, which is crazy to me.
Yeah, so, you know, you could go see the U.S. team play today in Jacksonville. We're going to do a lot of sports going on today. You got the U.S. team in Jacksonville, the U.S. soccer team in Jacksonville. Got the NBA Finals starting second game tomorrow. You got the NHL second game tonight. You got the Belmont Stakes, a horse running for the Triple Crown this afternoon at 6 o'clock. Sports everywhere.
It's crazy.
Let's talk about the NBA Finals.
Yes.
And the cramp heard around the world.
I haven't heard it like that yet, but it's very good. That's funny.
LeBron James playing in a sauna. In a sauna, because where the Spurs get me their stadium name, their arena name real quick. The Spurs Arena,
AT&T Stadium,
AT&T Arena or Stadium
Arena, I think.
AT&T Arena was a veritable sauna on Thursday night, as the air condition, some electrical system with the air quit working. Now, conspiracy theorists would say, yeah, so only the electrical went out to the air condition, but it stayed on for everything else. The fryers and the concession stands were able to make French fries. The lights were able to stay on. You were able to take showers because the water pumps were working and everything. But the electrical box to the air condition went out, and you couldn't fix that in 4 hours because you knew it was out an hour before the game. You can tell me that in a four-hour time period, you don't have an air conditioner man good enough to get the air conditioner back up and running?
You know, it kind of brings that whole home court advantage to the question here.
And then you have people say, well, they used to play in 1984 in the Boston Gardens. Boston Gardens, the old gardens, had no air conditioning.
Oh, yes. Because
had none.
It wasn't built for basketball. It was built for boxing.
Just what it was. It had no air conditioning. So you had to play in that. Somebody says, they did it in 84. They should be able to do it now. The problem was you knew you were going to do it in 84. You knew going into Boston that you knew you were going into a sauna. The Miami Heat didn't know they were going into a sauna in San Antonio Thursday night. My fault with LeBron James and with the Miami Heat. It's not really with LeBron James. It's with the Miami Heat medical staff. LeBron asked out of the game once and told them he was starting to cramp with about 4.5 minutes to go in the third quarter. Why wasn't LeBron immediately taken to the back, to the locker room, and given an IV of fluids right then?
He probably could have played the fourth quarter.
He would, if they had got him an IV of fluids in the third quarter, he could have played. He could have finished the game. Where was the medical staff saying, we need to get some fluids in you, an IV, the Gatorade or the Powerade or whatever the hell it is we're taking, you're drinking on the sideline, isn't working. Let's get you in the locker room, hook a bag of IV fluid up to you, ship it into your body. You know, 50. You got 4 minutes left in the third quarter. Then you got the 3.5 minute commercial break. Now, and then we can set you out the first 2 minutes of the fourth quarter. Now that's 10 minutes. Those IVs should kick in by then. You could probably play.
The game would have been entirely different after that.
However, people say he asked out. He quit on his team. Or obviously, people say, oh, he should have toughed it out. Obviously, those are the morons that have never played athletic sports at all. Because I'm here to tell you, I am one of the meanest SOBs you'll ever meet in your life when it comes to playing sports inside the white lines. Once that light goes on and the clock starts ticking, when I played, I was all business.
It is a business for him.
I cramped up at a game one time. Had to be taken out. And to take me out of a game, I almost had to have something broke. But when that leg seizes up and you can't put any weight on it because of a cramp, say what you want. Oh, it's just a cramp. Until you've experienced your leg not bending because the muscles seize up. That's what a cramp is. Everybody thinks a cramp's just a pain. A cramp is where your muscle spasms and seizes up and will not function anymore. Tough it out all you want, but when your muscle doesn't work, your leg doesn't work. And last time I checked, your leg must work to run. And in basketball, I may be wrong here, Ryan. I'm not the sports guy. You are. But isn't running imperative to the game of basketball?
Yes.
Is it the use of your leg, unless it's a wheelchair basketball game at the high school gym? Isn't your legs, aren't your legs imperative to playing the game of basketball?
I think it's essential.
Essential.
Yes, is the word I'm looking for.
LeBron's leg wouldn't function.
You can't blame the guy. He was doing all he could.
They were winning when he went out of the game.
Yeah.
Where was Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh, the other two-thirds of the big three, picking up the slack for the last 4.5, 5 minutes of the game?
Well, I thought Chris Bosh was like only showing up to the playoffs sometime. I guess he didn't show up the other night. He didn't make the trip to San Antonio. Wade, there's no excuse. He said he's in the best shape of his life, is what it said.
The best shape of his life. Better shape than LeBron James, obviously. Dwayne Wade didn't cramp up. The problem with this is the Miami Heat look bad because LeBron James cramps up, has to get taken out of the game, carried off the court, while Pat Riley, the president of the Heat, sitting over there in a sport coat and everything, not taking 100 degrees in there. He ain't taking the sport coat off. Pat Riley, I'm toughing it out. LeBron should too. Stop it with LeBron should tough it out.
I think the problem LeBron James has is he made all these promises when he got to Miami.
Yeah,
you know,
his whole problem. Everybody talks about the decision, and that's not what I think people should hate on LeBron about. The decision was what it is. It is how things are done these days. But he did donate $3 million that was raised during that one-hour TV show to the Boys and Girls Clubs of America. What I didn't like is when he got there, him and Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh, they came out with the explosions and the fog and the smoke and everything. And then he said, I don't know, how many are we going to win? 3, 4, 5, 6, and he just kept counting. How about winning the first one?
And then maybe think about a second one and a third one and a fourth one.
That's what, in my estimation, when it's all said and done, his numbers will be better than Kobe Bryant's. His numbers will be better than Michael Jordan's. He will be statistically able to be in the argument for greatest of all time.
But he's also going to be the most scrutinized of all time in that case.
But Michael Jordan nor Kobe Bryant ever told you they were going to win? They just went out and won. They never told you, hey, we'll win this many. All Kobe Bryant and Michael Jordan ever did is strapped on the shoes, tied them tight, put the jersey on, and went out and won. They didn't tell you they were going to win. LeBron James tells you how many he's going to win. All Kobe and Michael did is went out and won. Kobe not done with his career yet, but he's pretty much done.
He's in the last leg of it.
Michael been done for a while, even before he came back and played for the Wizards. But that's the one criticism I have of LeBron James. And I'll be perfectly honest, I'm a LeBron James fan.
I know a lot of people who are LeBron.
I'm not a Miami Heat fan. I'm a LeBron James fan. Just like back in the day, I was not a Lakers fan. I was not a Magic fan. I wasn't a Boston Celtics fan, but I loved Shaquille O'Neal because I liked who he was. And I wasn't really a Bulls fan. But I've been a 23 fan since he was a starting shooting guard for the University of North Carolina in 1982. Because I've been a Carolina fan since Phil Ford was the point guard for the North Carolina Tar Heels in the 70s. So I'm like exactly what the NBA wants. I'm a player fan, not a team fan when it comes to the NBA.
You're the type of fan who will buy the jersey for when he's on the Miami Heat, when he's on the Cavaliers.
I ain't buying anybody's jersey. I don't buy any other grown man's jersey. But I understand what you're saying. I'm the type of fan they want that'll buy the Cleveland jersey, the Miami jersey. If he goes to L.A., the L.A. jersey. I'll buy each jersey. Yes, I'm that type of fan. I have no allegiance to a team. I have an allegiance to the player. And I think LeBron James is great. I like LeBron James. The one knock on him during all the decision and everything was he counted how many he was going to win. And the greats don't count how many they're going to win. You think Bill Russell ever said, I'm going to win 11 championships with the Boston Celtics?
Probably not.
He just went out and won 11 championships with the Boston Celtics. Red Auerbach would have thrown Bill Russell under a bus if he'd have tried to say how many he was going to win. And that's the one knock on LeBron is don't talk about how many you're going to win. Go out and do it. And that's why people are so able to throw it. He says he's the most, what did he say? He says, I'm the most easiest target in the league for the social media message boards and all. And he says, I know that I am, but I can't play the game of basketball and live my life on what other people expect me to do or what they think I should do. That doesn't make me happy. What makes me happy is being able to play for my teammates, to be able to represent the name on the back of my jersey. See, he's not even representing Miami. He's representing the name on the back of his jersey.
Because he knows
James.
He knows he has a fan base wherever he goes. He knows right. The Miami exactly. Fan base will come and go, but he knows he has his followers. My friend, I have a friend who will defend LeBron James until he dies. And I ask him why. He's like, just because, you know, I feel like he is really good talent and he's really...
He is a great talent.
Oh, yeah. It's unarguable that he doesn't have he has a lot of talent.
He's the greatest player on the planet in basketball right now.
Oh, yes. That's...
It's not even arguable.
Yeah, you can't argue that. There's not anybody I can think of who is better.
But when you say you're going to win and then you ask out of games and you cramp up and you sit out the last 5 minutes of a finals game, after you say you're going to win championships instead of just going out and winning them, people then start throwing stones at you. That's just the nature. You said you were going to win. What's up, Big Mouth? What's going on? You run that gator and now you can't back it up? What's up with that? That's what people think. Whereas Michael Jordan just went out and won. He didn't tell anybody he was going to win. Believe me, if Joe Namath, who guaranteed that the Jets would beat the Colts in Super Bowl number 3, if Joe Namath, if the Jets hadn't have won that football game, we would think of Joe Namath as just some loudmouth who couldn't come through. But instead, Joe Namath, who has average numbers at best, is an NFL Hall of Famer because he said, I guarantee you we're going to win. And then he went out and won the game. If you're going to say you're going to win, you damn well better go out and win.
It's kind of like Rex Ryan says, everybody fears to play us, and then he loses 8-8.
If you guarantee you're going to win, you damn well better go out and win. And that's what LeBron did when he said, I don't know how many we're going to win. 3, 4, 5. When you say something like that, you better go out and win that many.
Oh, yes.
We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll get you set up for the NHL. The New York Rangers lose in overtime to a Kings team that just has no idea how to go away, even when they're down early. We'll talk about that. Plus, there's problems in Tar Heel land. A Tar Heel star says, I played a lot of basketball. I didn't do much else. I'll tell you who that is. Plus, the Madden cover was announced last night. Do we care?
I do. Well, I like Madden. That's my problem.
Plus, we're talking Belmont. Augie Griner Jr. stopped by the show on Thursday. We're going to talk about who he picked for the Belmont Triple Crown possibility today. California Chrome running for the Triple Crown, trying to unseed an Ocala Bred as the next Triple Crown winner. We'll talk about all that on the Saturday Sports Page, 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, WOCA, The Source.
Hi, it's Lisa Midget with Kinetic Motion Fitness. I'm looking forward to a fun, healthy summer, and I have a few ideas that might just help you and your friends stay in shape and have fun too. Along with awesome personal training and group classes at our warm and inviting fitness studio, we also offer fitness classes at your home or business. And if you're tired of the same old, boring cake and punch party, why not let us host a hot new health trend, a fitness party at your home or office? If you're having a hard time getting to the gym this summer, because of your crazy schedule, then work out with your friends or coworkers in a private group fitness class or host a fitness party at your home or office. We will bring you and your friends or coworkers one of our great workouts like Zumba, Piloxing, Body Bar, Yoga, Tai Chi, Boot Camp, or Zumbatomics for kids. We can even help you reach your long-term goals by meeting at your place weekly for an on-location workout. Check out our website at kmfocala.com and like us on Facebook. Kinetic Motion Fitness is located just 5 minutes from downtown Ocala near the Skylark Plaza. Kinetic Motion Fitness. We're ready when you are. Hi, it's Lisa Midget, owner of the brand new Proper Tea Salon. It's a perfect time to freshen up your cut and color for the new year. And if you really want to change up your look, talk to us about Hotheads extensions for extra volume and length. How about a blowout for date night? Give us a call. Enjoy some me time while you relax in our newly renovated salon and check in on Facebook using our free Wi-Fi. We know you'll be happy with your new look. We guarantee it. Our style guarantee assures you that no matter what, you will love your hair or we will fix it for free. Call for your appointment today, 352-351-1771. We're located in downtown Ocala, next to the Southside Deli. Tell us Buddy sent you for 20% off your first service visit. Now hiring licensed cosmetologists, nail techs, and front desk staff. Visit our website, thepropertees.com, for our online application. The Proper Tees Salon, timeless elegance meets classic sex.
Legally Yours, brought to you by Fuller & Fuller Attorneys at Law. On the air every Wednesday morning at 10:30 a.m. with John Fuller, a board-certified civil trial lawyer for over 25 years. John welcomes your questions, from business to complex family matters to legal disputes. So tune in every Wednesday morning at 10:30 a.m. for Legally Yours with John Fuller, right here on WOCA 1370 a.m. and 96.3 FM, The Source.
Putting the local back into radio. 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. WOCA News. Variety. Information. Now. Keep your arms and legs on the inside at all times.
This is WOCA News Talk 1370.
So let me get this right. We're coming back to a James Bond theme.
Yes.
Austin Tappman, if you're out there, please come to the radio station. Austin Tappman to the radio station, please. You just really played Skyfall by Adele, a James Bond theme, to come back to a sports show?
I had read a 6-page paper on the movie and I hadn't listened to the song, so I figured it's probably a good idea.
Austin Tappman, please come to the radio station if you're within the listening audience. It is Saturday Sports Page. I'm Tom Schmitz along with Ryan Goldberg. Although he's about to lose his last name for playing Skyfall by Adele. Coming back.
I was about to ask. I can't believe I still have my last name.
It's touch and go, pal. Touch and go. Let's talk about something manly instead of Skyfall by Adele.
Okay.
15 minutes into the Stanley Cup Finals, the Los Angeles Kings were down 2-0.
This is like the 10th time that's happened.
2-0. I'm a Rangers fan. I'm screaming at the TV. We got this. Oh, it's wonderful.
But as Barry Melrose does say, two-goal lead is not a lot in hockey. Even though it sounds like a lot. No, it's hard to score two goals.
Three goals is a huge lead. Two goals is not very many.
Yeah, you relax. And once you relax, it's hard to get going.
And that's exactly what happened to the New York Rangers. Second period, they relaxed. And Kyle Clifford scored a goal. Drew Doughty scored a goal. They tied it up in the second period. And then on the third period, it was a 0-0 third period. But the Los Angeles Kings outshot the New York Rangers 22-3. Lundqvist had to stand on his head to stop goals in the third period.
Lundqvist is a really good goalie. It's unarguable.
He's the only reason the Rangers are in the finals.
Yes. You know, I'm a Bruins fan at heart, but I'm really pulling for the Rangers. I like St. Louis. He was on the Tampa Bay Lightning. He got traded up there. You know, really gave him a shot at a Stanley Cup in his career. And this, I think it's the closest he's been since he's been in the NHL.
It is. Then his mother passed away and everything.
It was a great story.
But Henrik Lundqvist is just standing on his head in goal. He made 40 saves out there, but then with 4:36 gone in the overtime, a turnover. The Rangers turned the puck over in the zone. And the Kings put it top shelf, left top shelf, and the game's over. Kings win 3-2. That's the fifth straight overtime game.
For the Kings or for?
For the Kings. And they don't care.
I think they're like the third or fourth team in NHL history to make it to the Stanley Cup Finals by going to Game 7 for
every series. They played there was 21 games available in the first three rounds to play.
They played all 21.
They played all 21 of them, and the Rangers played 20 of 21.
Yeah.
So both these teams are battle-tested. The puck drops tonight at 7 o'clock. Rangers-Kings Game 2 at the Staples Center. I think the Rangers can beat the Kings.
I think so, too, but
they can't let up.
They have to attack. They have to attack Jonathan Quick, and it all comes down to him.
And I think the guy that really has to do it is Hagelin, because Hagelin is speed personified for the New York Rangers. He is the fastest guy on blades when he's out there. When his shift is on the ice, he's the fastest guy on the ice.
And I think the Rangers have to lead and attack the Kings with a strong forecheck and everything like that.
They cannot do like they did in game one when they got the 2-0 lead, and then they just dropped back out of the zone and wanted to play defense. Because the Kings just applied pressure, and when the pressure's applied, things happen.
I watched the first quarter of the game. I saw, the Rangers are up 2-0. Turned it off, went away.
I watched the entire three periods. And the overtime. Trust me, not really something you wanted anybody under the age of 18 to hear in my house once, you know, we got into the overtime. I was a little disgusted.
Yeah.
Game 2 drops tonight, 7 o'clock, New York Rangers versus the Los Angeles Kings for the Stanley Cup, Lord Stanley's Cup. I don't know if you saw this. Rashid McCants, the second leading scorer of the new North Carolina basketball team that won the 2004-2005 national title, beat Illinois for the title, said that Tudors wrote his term papers. I rarely went to class, only about half of the time at USC. I remained eligible to play largely because I took bogus classes designed to keep athletes like myself academically eligible. McCants told Outside the Lines of ESPN that he could have been academically ineligible to play during the championship game had he not been provided assistance. Further, he said, and this is the big part, head coach Roy Williams knew about all of this paper class system. The so-called paper classes doesn't require a student to go to class. Rather, they're only required to submit one term paper to receive a grade. And then he says tutors wrote that for him. He even made the dean's list in the spring of 2005, not attending any of his four classes, which he received straight A grades for.
I want to go to that college.
I want to go there. He was taking African American studies. That's where the basketball team, that's where the basketball program steered him, was towards African American studies, where he took the paper classes. He did not have to attend classes at North Carolina. He only had to turn in one term paper a semester.
I really want to do this class.
In a statement outside the lines on Thursday, UNC Athletic Director Bubba Cunningham said, "It is disappointing at any time a student is dissatisfied with his or her experience. I welcome the opportunity to speak with Rashad McCants about returning to UNC to continue his academic career, just as we have welcomed many former student athletes interested in completing their degree." Well, I'll go back and complete my degree if I can go to the paper classes where I just write one term paper. I think that when the NCAA does an investigation of this, this is going to be troublesome for the North Carolina Tar Heels. And they could strip them of their 2004-2005 national championship.
You read my mind. I was just about to ask that question.
Oh, yeah. They could very well get stripped. And I, full disclosure, am a huge North Carolina basketball fan.
I know a lot of North Carolina basketball fans.
Rashad McCants was one of the best players of the 2000s. And if this is accurate, it just proves even farther that it's really athlete-student, not student-athlete.
It is.
That it's all about winning games so coaches continue to make million-dollar paychecks off the backs of players.
I think I saw your article you posted on your blog.
I did. I posted an article on my blog, put it out there on Facebook. If you want to go to it, you can go to my Facebook page, Tom Schmidt's Facebook page. It's also on the Voice of Ocala Facebook page. The blog that I wrote is just about this type of deal where players are being used so coaches can make big paychecks. It was announced this week that John Calipari's now just got a bump in his pay up to $50 million. The coach at Alabama, Nick Saban, it was just announced that he has $55.2 million. So I wrote a blog called Getting Rich on the Backs of Student Athletes. If you want to go read that blog, it's on Facebook, at my Facebook page, at the Voice of Ocala Facebook page. But it just shows that the student athlete tuition isn't cutting it, folks. That's not enough now. And if you don't believe me, look at how the five major conferences are telling the NCAA we need to change our bylaws so that we can compensate the student athlete. Because if you don't start compensating the student athlete, if you keep doing this shady stuff behind the scenes, writing papers for them and everything, you're going to have more and more of this come out because more and more people will pay for this story. Deadspin and people like that will pay good money for these stories. And Rashad McCants, who's over in Europe playing now, he's not making NBA money. I don't know if Outside the Lines gave him anything for his appearance. I don't know. But I know places like Deadspin, TMZ, places like that pay good money for sports stories like this that could shock and rock the NCAA. And they're going to continue to happen until you do something about the inequity of coaches making millions, athletic program making, University of Florida's athletic program made $130 million last year.
I'd be happy with that for like a career lifetime.
$130 million last year. And it wasn't even the top one, Texas was.
That's crazy.
So something's got to happen or you're going to continue to hear stories like Rashad McCants saying, "Yeah, I ain't got no allegiance to my school. They let me skate through trying to win." More about this later. Hey, we're going to take a break. We come back. Augie Griner Jr. joined the show on Thursday talking to Belmont Stakes. We'll hear from Augie Griner Jr. next on Saturday Sports Page, 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, WOCA, The Source.
Hello, I'm Dawn Lovell, lead event designer and owner at Party Time Rentals. Have you ever wondered what it takes to make an event spectacular? Well, look no further. It's what we do every day. Whether you're hosting an intimate dinner for 10 or a gala for thousands, at Party Time Rentals, we find just the right style and elegance to make your event a success. Our extensive inventory of the finest in chandeliers, tents, crystal, china, and specialty items is featured in our fabulous showroom. Stop by and say hello. It's a great way to get ideas for an event and experience for yourself how you can make your party time special.
Party Time Rentals, located on Southwest 10th Street, just off Route 200 in Ocala, and off Southwest 34th Street in Gainesville. For more information, call 352-629-8858. That's 352-629-8858. The party begins at Party Time.
Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And so is State Farm agent Angie Lewis, working hard to serve her community as a citizen and insurance agent. Angie wants to help you as you adjust your insurance needs to your life, from everything to helping educate your teen driver to protecting your family against everyday risk. She wants to change the way you perceive insurance by developing relationships with her clients, which is why Angie and her staff are proud to be a part of so many good causes in Ocala. In turn, she has chosen to single out those who step up as leaders. Each month on The Voice of Ocala, Angie spotlights a good neighbor, saluting those who give exceptional service or do random acts of kindness to others. For this, Angie was written up in State Farm's National Magazine. Angie also supports local businesses with a regular Biz Buzz. The Angie Lewis State Farm Agency is located at 1122 Northeast 36th Avenue, where visitors are always welcome and the coffee pot is always on.
Gene Powell Pass Chemoing. Our tractor services include bush hog, disking, front end loader, box blade, and stump grinding. We also have zero turn mowers for the smaller paddocks, aisleways, fence rows, and lawn care. Fence row spraying is also available for weed control. We are licensed and insured. Gene Powell Pass Chemoing, 352-629-2440 or online at PowellGene, G-E-N-E, at yahoo.com. Gene Powell Pass Chemoing.
Habitat for Humanity of Marion County is a ministry dedicated to improving lives by providing affordable and decent housing. Help them help others by visiting the Habitat for Humanity Ocala Restore at 926 Northwest 27th Avenue. To schedule a donation, give us a call at 401-0075 and we'll come pick it up. For more information, visit ocalarestore.org. Habitat for Humanity of Marion County. Building homes, building hope, building community.
We are The Source, WOCA, new talk, sports, and more.
Start it.
Zombie on the track.
Started from the bottom, now we here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team here. Started from the bottom, now we here.
We're back on the Saturday Sports Man. That's a much better song than
I thought you'd like that.
Skyfall. I want to hear, well, you ought to come back with Turn Down for What? I like that song.
I'll do
too.
It next break.
Got to make sure it's the clean version, though, because, you know, we can't have the real Turn Down for What. It is a Saturday Sports Page. I'm your host, Tom Schmidt, along with Ryan Goldberg.
Still have his last
Buddy name. Martin just texted me and gave me a little bit of information. OTL, Outside the Lines, does not pay for any story. So I guess Rashad McCants didn't get any money, but I know Deadspin and TMZ, places like that, pay for their stories. But Outside the Line, ESPN does not, Buddy Martin says, pay for stories. So Buddy Martin, much more versed in that than I am, so I'm going with what Buddy Martin tells me.
So then it has to be true because he didn't have any incentive to make up a story.
And Buddy Martin, you know, I work for him, so if he says that, I'm just going to say, but that's right, okay. Not really. If I don't think Buddy's right, Buddy and I've had some back and forth when I didn't think he was right.
Well, it's his show, so
it is his show. It is his show.
I'm going to side with him.
I side with Buddy a lot, I'll be honest with you. To the point where I'm getting blamed for being a liberal now. I'm just saying. Where Buddy's not even a liberal. Buddy's just a middle-of-the-road guy that makes his decisions as they come. But, you know, he gets blamed sometimes.
Buddy's a simple man sometimes.
Buddy's a great guy.
Yes, he is.
He's, as long as he keeps signing my check, he's even better than most. And he's listening right now, so it's not hurting to butter him up a little bit either.
Oh, yes.
You know what I mean? So, hey, earlier this week, Augie Griner Jr. stopped by the show talking about the Belmont Stakes. Before we go to Augie Griner Jr., though, the odds as of an hour ago, Ryan Goldberg, on today's Belmont are what?
For California Chrome, it is 4-5 on.
4-5 for California Chrome.
Yes. For Metal Count, it's 20-1. For Matterhorn, it's 33-1. For Commanding Curve, it's 11-1. Riding on Curlin, it's 7-1. Matuzak, thank you. It's 50-1, which is that's a butt bet right there.
Yeah, that's up from 30-1.
Oh yes.
Samurat
is 25-1.
Commissioner
33-1.
Wicked Strong.
That's my
wait. Point. Hold on. How should I say that correct?
Wicked.
No. Give me the Boston accent.
I don't have a Boston.
Wicked. I can't do it. I can't do a Boston accent.
I'll get my cousins to call in next time we do this.
So what's Wicked Strong at?
6-1.
All right. General A-Rod.
Is 28-1.
Yeah, well, unless he's got his steroids this morning. I don't know. Oh, wait. No, that's Alex Rodriguez. I'm sorry.
I was about to make the joke. But
and okay. Tunnelist.
17-2. That's another good bet.
17-2 is not a bad bet at all. So that's 8.5-1 where he was 8-1. So there's your morning odds as of an hour ago at Belmont. Buddy Martin had Augie Griner Jr. on the show on Thursday talking to Belmont Stakes. Here's what they had to say about a run for the Triple Crown.
And Augie Griner Jr. here is with us, and it's time to talk about some horse racing and what could be a golden moment on Saturday. Augie, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I really think he's probably going to do it. I mean, he is the best three-year-old in this crop. You know, the only thing that worries you is the Belmont is just a weird type of race, and it's always a jocks race. You know, you got all these jockeys out there. I mean, obviously they know California Chrome is the one to beat now, so everybody's going to try to beat him and box him in and do this and do that, you know. So he's got the target on his back. So, I mean, it's going to be tough. But I think of all the horses that had a chance, he probably has the best chance based on his running style. So,
which is?
Well, you know, you have a lot of horses sometimes that are, you know, either front runners or deep closers. And, you know, if you're a front runner, you need to be able to break well and get out there on the front and hopefully not go too fast. You know, if you're a deep closer, you need somebody on the front end to run real fast. You have something to close into. Well, California Chrome's the type of horse, he can pretty much sit anywhere in the race. He can be on the front. He can sit, you know, right off the lead. He can be mid-pack. I mean, you know, and he's got that push-button acceleration that gets him in the race no matter where he's positioned in the race and no matter what the pace is. And so he's got a lot of options on what the way he can run this race and win this race.
Augie,
that's the characteristic that Secretariat had. He had a lot of power. He could run for pretty much everywhere, too. The problem I see, you know, the little limited knowledge I've had, I've kind of covered a few Belmonts and Triple Crowns, is that front runners don't do well at the Belmont.
Actually, they do.
They do?
Yeah, and actually, I brought all the past, because I knew you were going to say that.
So I've never seen, well, of course, Secretariat would be, obviously, he did quite well and won by 32 links.
Actually, Secretariat, Seattle Slew, and Affirmed all won going gate to wire.
They did. And I know that.
And most of the horses that win the Belmont, a lot of them went on the front end. It gets back to, like I said, you know, the Belmont is a weird run race because, you know, most of the races, even the Kentucky Derby at a mile and a quarter, are run in a typical fashion. You let horses go out there on the front end and run pretty fast and everything, and horses kind of position themselves based on, you know, how they normally run a race, you know. Whereas in the Belmont, no horse is going to run out there and run real fast at the beginning. They all kind of lope along and get position, and they try to slow it down as much as they possibly can to save their horse for like the last 6 furlongs or quarter mile or so, and then they really start running and picking it up. So really, the Belmont is a mile and a half race, but they don't really race for a mile and a half. It's really only, it's less than a mile that they're actually running, really, against each other.
Yeah, and thinking about the closers, Tom, I know you want to make a comment, but the picture I have in my mind, the Silver Charm,
yeah,
standing with Diane Dudley at the finish line, trying to win a Triple Crown, could have won it, and seeing Touch Gold come around the side
right,
and win that by head.
Right.
If that closer won it. I guess I'm thinking that that's the image I have for closers. But
right. Well, I mean, if you look back at these charts, and I printed up all these charts of like the last, you know, 15 or 20 Belmonts just to kind of prove the point.
I'm glad you did.
You know, and one other thing, too, is like, again, it's like kind of how I'm talking about time of a race. Like, you look at the Kentucky Derby, that's a mile and a quarter. And the figure you want to look at for this race to see whether or not California Chrome is probably going to win or not is the 6-furlong split and the mile split. Just to give you an example, in the Kentucky Derby, the 6-furlong split was a minute 11 and 4. That's what the leader ran in the
Derby?
First six at the Derby.
Okay.
So a minute 11 and 4. Okay. In the Preakness, it was a minute and 11. So okay. that's pretty typical of a race. I mean, yeah. Somewhere right around there, you know.
Yeah.
Where in the Belmont, if you look at the last 10 Belmonts, for example, yeah. The average 6-furlong time is about a minute 14 and change or a minute 15. I mean, that's 40 seconds slower.
Yeah, yeah.
The mile, the Derby, the mile, they probably ran about 136 or something like that, you know, 137. And the Belmont, they're probably going to 140. Mm-hmm. I mean, so it's like it's so much slower up to that point, and then they start running after that, you know. So horses try to conserve their energy and slow it down as much as they can on the front end. To try to win the race.
Augie Griner Jr. bringing horse racing metrics talk to us to prove me wrong.
Well, Augie Griner, another point that I would like to make, and you can expound on, this is known, the Belmont, unlike the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness, is known as a rider's race. This is not so much a horse, this is a rider. And Victor Espinoza, who is on California Chrome, for lack of a better term, is horrible in mounts at the Belmont. How much is that going to weigh into Saturday?
Well, again, I mean, it depends on what type of horse you're on. It kind of goes back to, like, him being on War Emblem, like, 12 years ago. War Emblem was going for the Triple Crown in the Belmont. He was a dead front-running horse. And when he broke bad in the Belmont, he had no chance to win the race. So that's not Victor Espinosa's fault. That's a horse that needs a certain type of running style, and the race is set up exactly how he needs it to win. And California Chrome doesn't need that. So, I mean, you have to have the horse to win the race. But, yes, the Belmont is definitely a jockey's race because, again, the jockeys are trying to slow the pace down as much as they can to conserve their horse so they can possibly win a race.
He's,
not only that,
he's 4-31, though.
Well, there's a lot of jockeys that haven't even won the Belmont. I mean, you know, so that's not that bad. But the thing about it is that, you know, all the jockeys are now ganging up to try to beat California Chrome. So in a normal race, you're not going to have jockeys kind of like, you know, trying to box a horse in.
Box him in, you think?
Right, and now they probably will.
Does a two-box help or hurt that? Two-hole.
I don't think it matters too much. He's got tactical speed. He can position himself well. I mean, he'd rather be on the outside so he can kind of like, you know, get clear on the outside a little bit easier. But the other thing I was going to mention, too, is like we get back to, you know, pace in this race and the horses on the front end. This race really has no horse that is a front-running type of style.
What about the...
Interesting to see. Go ahead.
What about the horses, though, that took the Preakness off and have one less race and are deemed a little fresher that are coming back now to take a run at California Chrome?
Well, and that's a big factor you have to worry about, you know. But again, what I was just saying was, is like, you know, even those horses, there aren't really any front-running types of horses that you have to really worry about of going out in front and stealing the race. Like, I remember being on the show a couple of years ago, and I have it right in front of me. There's a horse named Painter that I said could go steal the race on the front end. And he almost did it, and the Union Rags caught him at the very end. There's no horse like that in this race that could go on the front and steal the race, you know, that you have to worry about. So California Chrome really doesn't have to worry about any horse getting out in front of him and stealing the race from him, so he can position himself anyway.
Sounds like you're talking about, unless he has a bad trip, he's going to win this Triple Crown.
Pretty much. I mean, you know, or unless he just is a lot more worn out than we think he is. I mean, from everything we've seen in his workouts and how he's been acting at Belmont, he looks great. Everybody says he's looking great and doing well. So unless he's fooling everybody and is actually a lot more worn out than he is showing, yeah, unless he has a bad trip, he should win the race. Because it's going to be hard for him to get in a bad spot.
Yeah. Let's talk about money. Let's
hang
talk.
On a second,
okay.
Bob, hang on one second. I want to get back to this point. And that is that the metrics you throw at me are really good. I learned something about that. But I also come back to what you just said. We know these old school metrics. It's a grueling three races, these horse fat. There is some collateral damage. It just wears these colts out. I mean, it's proven it has. And then you add the extra distance of the Belmont, what I always like to refer to as Heartbreak Hill, where so many good horses have died. How many have we had that won since our firm and won the double and not like 12 horses?
Yeah, I think this is like the 13th. Yeah,
yeah. There's a reason that happens. That, right, is that part of it?
Oh, it definitely is. I mean, yeah, and as I was telling Tom James before we came on the air, you know, I mean, there's a lot of reasons why we haven't had Triple Crown winner in a long time. Not only has the breeding kind of gone more towards speed, you know, than it was in the past, but also in the past, you didn't have a whole lot of people run their horse in the Derby, they just skip the Preakness and then come back in the Belmont with a fresh horse. If they ran in the Derby, they pretty much ran in all three races, you know. I mean, so this is kind of a new phenomenon, you know. So yeah, that's a big, I mean, you got Wicked Strong who ran, you know, what, third in the Derby or fourth in the Derby. He's coming back. He's a lot fresher. Yep. You know, you got a couple other ones, you know, they're coming back fresh. I mean, you know, that obviously helps because a five-week break as opposed to a three-week break with a race in between. I mean, you know, that's a lot different.
One more thing, Augie. When you lay it all out there and you look at the metrics and all the thing research that you've done, impressive amount of paperwork you have there, what does it look like to you on Saturday in terms of who challenges and how? I'm kind of feeling you're going to pick California Chrome, as you've done, by the way, the last two races.
Well, I am going to pick California Chrome. I just think that, you know, no matter what happens, he's going to find himself in a position that he can still win the race from. I mean, I don't think you're going to have anybody going to go out there and win the race on the front end. I mean, you got a horse like Tonalist, who's a new shooter who won the Peter Pan up there at Belmont. But if you look at his past performances, you know, he won the Peter Pan in the slop, and that's by far the best race he's ever run in his life on the front end. So he probably just loved the slop at Belmont, and, you know, so you got to almost have to throw that race out. So, you know, so other than him, there's really no other horse that wants the front end. And if California Crimson doesn't have to worry about somebody winning it on the front end, stealing a race from him, I think it's going to be hard for him to beat.
That was Augie Griner Jr. saying that he believes California Chrome is the cream of the crop here, and the betting line says so right now. 4-5 favorite this morning as of an hour ago. So California Chrome, 4-5 favorite at the Belmont this afternoon around 6 o'clock. I think it runs somewhere around there. So we're going to take a break. When we come back, the new Madden cover, Richard Sherman or Cam Newton. They were both the finalists in the online voting. Once again, ESPN did something that aggravates me. They did it last night concerning the Madden cover. Plus, the U.S. World Cup team plays in Jacksonville today, and the head coach, Jurgen Klinsmann, said he doesn't even know who the starting team's going to be yet for the World Cup. That's kind of interesting to me. Plus, are you kidding me? All that next on the Saturday Sports Page, 1370 AM, 96.3 FM. We're live and local on The Source.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingram, CEO of Gateway Bank, inviting you to drop by our main office on Silver Springs Boulevard every Friday from 3 to 6 p.m. for the Community Gazette, a three-hour show focusing on our favorite community to live and work, Ocala, Marion County. Come join us with the voice of Ocala, Buddy Martin, in the new old-fashioned bank radio studio as we discuss a variety of interesting topics on the Community Gazette on WOCA, The Source.
You know, Austin, I'm sitting here at the computer looking at our Facebook page, and boy, we really need to tell more listeners about our Facebook page.
No, Tom, see, you got it all wrong. Twitter is the new age.
What's a tweeter?
No, a Twitter, Tom. The Voice of Ocala has a Twitter.
We do? Well, how do we tell our listeners about that?
All they have to do is get the Twitter app or go to twitter.com, type in Voice of Ocala in the search box, and click follow.
All right, well, what's the tweeter do?
The Voice of Ocala's Twitter page updates all of its followers on the latest news, guests, giveaways, and contests.
Oh, okay. But couldn't listeners just tune in weekdays from 3 to 6 to 1370 AM and 96.3 FM, or even go to online at WOCA.com? Wouldn't that be easier?
Yeah, okay, maybe.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingram, CEO of Gateway Bank, the new old-fashioned bank. Let us introduce you to Okus, a simple way to bring your business online. Through this relationship, your business can have a fully functioning website in less than 30 minutes. We will also provide you support with social media, sales tracking, e-commerce, and online scheduling, which is all optimized for mobile users. Okus, now at Gateway Bank, Silver Springs Boulevard, Ocala. Come visit our technology center for your total small business solution. I'm Tom Ingram, and I'll see you there.
Here's what you may have missed on the John Tesh Radio Show.
Most men also viewed home improvement projects as a way of expressing how much they care for their families.
Exercise alone will help you drop about 2 to 3% of your weight over a year. But if you cut your diet by 500 calories a day, you'll lose a pound a week. Look for a partner with happily married parents. This is especially important if your mom and dad got a divorce.
Intelligence for your life on the John Tesh Radio Show. Don't miss this stuff.
You've got a garden and we've got a show for you, called You've Got a Garden with your host, Master Gardener Carol Ann Baldwin. Carol Ann answers your questions about your flowers, your veggies, your grass, your trees, even questions about your bugs. And she's only on WOCA, so don't miss Carol Ann Baldwin and You've Got a Garden each Tuesday from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. right here on WOCA The Source.
1370 WOCA.
We're back on the Saturday Sports Page. I'm Tom Schmitz along with Ryan Goldberg. See, now that's music coming back in.
I don't like that song.
You don't like that song?
No.
I bet you don't like Shot.
No, I don't mind
shot.
That song.
Everybody. Same guy?
You saw me running to work this morning.
I know.
Windows
I know.
Down, cruising.
Rolling, I know.
I was going to come in here like Austin does with the sunglasses on, just don't take them off.
I understand, but Austin's no longer part of the show. We don't talk about him anymore. He's he's who we don't speak of.
Since the man who talked to him all the first hour we were here.
We don't speak of him. Jurgen Klinsmann says he wants to continue to fine-tune and improve the starting lineup for the U.S. soccer team against Nigeria today as they take on Nigeria at Everbank Field in Jacksonville. He says, we're talking about a team that will give us hopefully a lot of answers to many of our questions. A reporter asked him, does he already have a lineup in mind for the opener? And he says, absolutely. Every coach has at this point. This is why you have these send-off games, to give minutes to players who are right there. So you won't see exactly the lineup Saturday that we have in mind. So we will not put the starting lineup out on the field Saturday against Nigeria. Here's the thing. What I think is worse than that is Jurgen Klinsmann said earlier this week, we can't win the World Cup.
I clicked on that article when you were asking me about it, and I was like, wait, this can't be right.
He said, we can't win the World Cup. We'd have to play 7 perfect games to win the World Cup. We're not there yet. But he gave hope. He says, we're not there yet. Before, other coaches were like, you know, we can't win, and the world's much better. Jurgen Klinsmann says, we can't win yet. It's going to take, everybody says, when is soccer going to take off in this country? With the MLS, and there's, don't get me wrong, there are lots of people that go watch the MLS, and I'm going to go watch the Orlando City Lions. I'm going to go watch them when they start, just because it's close enough I can go.
I'll be in Orlando. I might do that now.
You know, but soccer is still not one of the 4 major sports. And if it ever wants to, it's going to happen by the U.S. winning the World Cup.
I was just about to say.
Until the U.S. wins a World Cup, soccer will always be that game kids play until they get old enough to play. All kids play until they get old enough to start playing other sports, except for the few diehard kids that play soccer.
I played soccer growing up.
Because it's going to take something on the world stage to get people to be interested in the game of soccer on the same scale they are with baseball or basketball or football or hockey.
But you think if soccer became a major sport, one of the three the major sports, you think you'd have to kick something out like hockey or basketball or something like that?
No, I think we could sustain another sport.
You think so?
Yeah. Because just one of those 4 would become the fringe sport. Soccer's like right on the cusp. It's like the 5th sport. In my opinion, it's like right on the cusp now. It's closer now than it's ever, ever been to being a mainstream sport.
I haven't been to
Right there.
I haven't been to a professional soccer game yet, but now I'm intrigued.
Right. It's right there. The Ocala Stampede had their opening game Thursday night. Lots of people went out to Trinity Catholic to watch the Ocala Stampede play in the PDL. So, you know, we got a team right here in Ocala, great soccer right here in Ocala you can go watch. ESPN did something again last night that ticks me off. They created the television show out of garbage.
I thought ESPN was just garbage.
And it aggravates me. Last night, they took a whole hour show that they created so that EA Sports could tell you who's on the cover of Madden.
ESPN is all about the hype. They are experts at that.
There's only one other company better at hype than ESPN.
I don't know who.
The World Wrestling Entertainment System.
Okay, yeah.
Okay.
I didn't think about
Vince
that.
McMahon and his people are the only people that rival ESPN when it comes to making chicken salad out of well, you know how that ends.
I do now because you explained it to me last time you said it.
Last night they did an entire hour show on who the winning cover for Madden is, Madden NFL 15. And your winner, the finalists were Richard Sherman and Cam Newton. And your winner, Richard Sherman, Seattle Seahawks cornerback. Only the third time a defensive player has made that distinction. Along, he joins now Troy Polamalu and Ray Lewis as the only defensive players ever to grace the Madden cover.
He is the second one to be on the cover by himself because Ray Lewis was on by himself.
Troy Polamalu was on with Larry Fitzgerald.
Yes.
Yes. I'm up on the date. Look, hey, I know Madden. You know, relax.
I'm just quoting.
He's the second Seattle Seahawk also. Sean Alexander was on, I think, in 2007. Sean Alexander was on.
I didn't play Madden until last year.
I think it was 2007. So, Richard Sherman only in his fourth NFL career, just finished his fourth season. Now he's on the cover of Madden. Good job, ESPN. Who cares? Are you kidding me? I turned on the TV Thursday night, and I saw Bud Selig walking to the podium on MLB Network to do the Major League Baseball draft like they do the basketball draft or the football draft. At least I know some of the people playing basketball. At least I know some of the people playing football. What the hell do I want to watch TV for so he can tell me about a high school kid from Mission Viejo, California that I've never heard of before? The Major League Baseball draft on TV makes about as much sense as if you got a weak stomach going to an autopsy. The Major League Baseball draft on TV is stupid. Nobody knows those kids. Don't put it on TV. For Ryan Goldberg, I'm Tom Schmidt saying have a great weekend, everybody.